Hey, what's up, everybody? This is your boy Kenny, and this is If Loving You Is Wrong, Episode 5. And I believe the title of this episode is An Unlikely Suspect. Yeah, that's it. So, the episode opens up where it left off from the previous episode, where Alex runs her car into a tree. The damn car catches on fire, so Alex is fucking stranded. Next, they actually show Kelly, Marcy, and Stevens, where finally Marcy reveals that Brad had red mud on his shoes, but at Bandit Mountain, the mud is brown, so they immediately notice that as being suspicious. So pretty much, Stevens says he's going to look into it. Next thing you know, Esperanza shows up, and you know, and she pretty much goes to meet with Kelly and Marcy. Stevens is walking back to the house and sees that Eddie's ass is still there at the scene, sitting in the damn police car. And he's going in on Eddie's ass like, why the fuck are you here? He's like, what do you mean? I'm a police officer. I want to be in on this case. He's like, you're not needed here. Why don't you go to Abandoned Mountain? He's like, well, why the hell would I go to Abandoned Mountain? Why don't you send one of your damn rookies to do it? I'm like, Eddie, you are such a disrespectful bastard, young. It's like, no matter what, I mean, he's your lieutenant, so he's your boss, and it's like, you just be literally giving him your ass to kiss. And he's saying that I need someone up there, you know, to kind of block it until we do a thorough investigation as to what this case is. And he's like, well, what do you mean? You know, Eddie's just being real nonchalant, but really Eddie's just there to be nosy as hell and to get intel. And, you know, Eddie has his own way of doing shit, as we have known from the previous seasons. So, eventually he tells him, like, look, go to damn Bandit Mountain and get your ass up out of here. And Eddie pretty much really ain't, Eddie pretty much is still kind of like, yeah, sure, boss, I'll go. Yeah, okay. And Stevens goes off and drives the car. You know, well, I'm sorry. Stevens actually goes off, gets into his car, and he drives off. Then we have this officer named Rick who is going back in the house, and Eddie stops him. So obviously him and Rick know each other, you know, on the force. I think they probably, I mean, this is just my hypothetically speaking, I think they probably became officers around the same time. So he asks Rick, yo, what the hell Stevens think he going? Ain't this supposed to be a murder investigation? I mean, ain't they supposed to be like an investigation here? Where the hell is Stevens going? And he said, well, Stevens is going to go look into a suspect. And he's saying, who's the suspect? And at first, Rick was not going to say anything. But, you know, Eddie pretty much kept pushing it until Rick finally said Bradley Montgomery. So he's like, oh, so why is he going for Brad? He's like, well, according to Miss Louise's confession, that Brad was the one who came in and beat up her, who pretty much attacked her, and then he was the one who kidnapped Randall and the baby. So they've already done drawn all this that Brad is the one that's responsible for all of this. So Eddie's pretty much taking it all down, and Rick goes back in. Next thing you know, Esperanza goes to the car. Her and Eddie go back and forth, and they keep doing this damn love-hate bullshit that obviously is really getting on my fucking nerves. So, and pretty much, you know, they also pretty much realize that, yeah, Miss Louise was the one who told the police that Brad was the one that attacked her and kidnapped Randall. Next thing you know, they go back to Marcy and Brad's apartment. Brad is drinking, still cleaning up the blood from his ear where Marcy hit him in the head with the bottle. He gets a call, and it's Eddie. Eddie's calling this fool on a burnt phone, lets him know he needs to get his ass up out of there. He needs to meet him somewhere because, you know, they're coming for you. And he's pretty much told him that, look, they are saying that, you know, Randall's mother pretty much said that you were the one who attacked her and you were the one who kidnapped Randall and the baby. And Brad is like, what the fuck? I had nothing to do with this. He's like, yeah, but, you know, And he also lets her know that Lieutenant Stevens was the one who talked to Marcy. Which, finally, it dawns on Brad's mind, like, that's why she went off on me. So, Eddie is being adamant with him, like, look, you know, you don't have to tell me, like, just let me know where you buried the bodies, and, you know, I'll take care of everything. I have no, I'll be there for you. And I'm like, you limey motherfucker. Because Eddie is just like all game in, like, oh, if you kill somebody, you know I got you. You my boy. You know, just let me know where the bodies are. And Brad's like, there are no fucking bodies. I didn't kill anybody. I didn't hurt anyone. You know? And Eddie's like, look, whatever. It doesn't matter. But, you know, just let me know where the bodies are. You know? And, you know, I'll take care of it. Don't worry about it. You know, I got you. You know? And, and then, but the thing about it, I am under suspicion, because we did see in the first episode of this season that Brad was digging this grave. And Eddie mentioned it. So I'm thinking he did that for a favor for Eddie. So I'm thinking, in my perspective, Eddie knows that they got Randall, and he knows this shit. And he used Brad to dig the grave to put Randall in. This is just my prediction, but I think Eddie knows more than he's letting on. Because he's like, oh yeah, digging a grave is hard work. So he knows that Brad was digging a grave. So yeah, and plus, you know, Dusty, whatever the fuck his name is, you know, Alex's father, that's his uncle. So I think, yeah, Eddie knows more than he's letting on, and I think he just used Brad to dig the grave. But yeah, but eventually Brad was like, look, I'm getting off this damn phone. You know, he's like, look, won't you meet me here at this location? You know, you need to get about there, because they're coming for you. They're going to arrest you. And, you know, so he pretty much got the heads up, but Brad just was like, fuck it, no, whatever, I don't care, and hangs up the phone. Alright, next we actually see that Kelly, Esperanza, and Marcy are at Alex's house. Brad is trying to call Marcy, and, you know, all of this is really starting to get to Marcy, that Marcy, you know, feels like she's going to get sick, and she runs into the bathroom. While she's in the bathroom, Esperanza and Kelly start talking. And while they're having a conversation, she notices that Travis is calling, and that Travis has been calling, and that he's called a record of 39 fucking times. Now, if you don't think that Travis is fucking crazy, this should ring the alarm that this is not a motherfucker you don't want to, that you don't want around you, more or less. This is not a motherfucker that you're going to just brush off like he's going to go away. And she actually played all the voice messages, and you hear how one minute he's begging her, then the next minute he's cussing her out, the next minute he's pleading to love him and that he loves her and that he wants to be there for her in justice. Then the next minute she's a ruthless, gruesome, life-sucking bitch and all of this shit. And I'm like, wow. So this is what you got on your hands. And Esperanza, I have to say, as much as I can't stand her ass, in this scene, this is the first time Esperanza made sense. She said, look, you need to, what the hell are you doing? Like, this fool is crazy. Like, this dude's a lunatic. Like, you need to get protection. You need to get a restraining order. Like, and then she also told, and Kelly did mention that, yes, he's been creeping out, just popping up at her house anytime, and he has a car that's staked out in front of her house, and he was at a window and all of this stuff. So, it's like, okay, Kelly, that's kind of an alarm that, yeah, this dude is crazy, and obviously he's not going to stop. And Esperanza said the same thing, like, look, he's not going to stop. You need to, you know, report this. And that, you know, you need to file a police report. Like, what the hell are you doing, Kelly? And then Kelly's like, oh, he'll calm down. Oh, yeah. And she also, and Esperanza said, like, what kind of sex voodoo did you do to this fool? And she's like, really? Really, Esperanza? I'm like, but for real, though. I mean, shoot. You must have done something that got that fool completely out of his mind. But then the problem, she says that he'll calm down. You stupid black bitch. And this is why I'm saying this. That motherfucker was about to rape you on your fucking porch, and the only thing that stopped him was your son and... was your son and Nika coming outside. If they were not to come outside, that fool would have choked you out and he would have stole your black box and would have been a damn thing you could have done. But he's going to calm down? And that's not the first time he's choked you out. This is the second time he choked your ass. But he's going to calm down? Just sit your ass down, man. What the fuck? I'm so blown with that. I was so pissed off. I'm like, really, bitch? You not gonna quit until this fool fucking kills you? Let me move on, because she really pissed me off with that. Next, we see Natalie and Lucian's at the hospital, and then Hardy, who's Joey's probation officer, shows up, and immediately, that rings an alarm to Lucian. Then Lucian pulls Hardy aside and has a conversation. He's like, first of all, you know that he's pretty much he's pretty much being operated on right now. So what makes you think, right now, we don't know whether he's going to live or die. So why are you here? And he's saying that, well, you know, we all know that he had we pretty much know that, you know, he had a gun, and that's a violation of his probation. He's like, okay, we can deal with that later, but why are you here? You know, we don't know if this boy is going to live or die. You know, why are you here? As a matter of fact, why don't you get the hell out of here? You know, and then he's like, well, I'll just talk to Natalie. He's like, oh, no, you don't need to say a damn thing to Natalie. You can talk to me. As a matter of fact, here's my car. You can talk to me directly. Don't say nothing to Natalie. He's like, okay. Okay, Natalie, good night. I hope everything's okay. And I'm like, oh, motherfucker really playing games. I'm like, oh, okay. Because I definitely remember Hardy, because in season one, he was flirting with Natalie. So I'm like, okay, what's your aim, Hardy? You know, and actually immediately when she saw him, she started to panic, and she's like, oh, my God, no. Because remember the last episode, she talked to Esperanza, and she said that he had a gun, which is a violation to his probation. So whether he lives or dies, he's screwed either way. Because due to the fact that he had a gun, he's going to go back to jail. So eventually Hardy goes off. And immediately, Natalie's like, look, you know, he's been calling me all the time. He always calls me, and he flirts with me, too. And she's like, oh, really? He's like, yeah, he be flirting with me. And then we actually come to find out that at the time of the shooting, Fawn had $15,000 on her, and we also know that she's the person that goes to all of her father's stores to collect all the money. So, and that the gun that was used was actually registered to her dad, because it was her father's gun, as we remember from season two. Now, my whole thing is, first of all, why the hell did her father, and Natalie brought this up, why the fuck would her father have her going to all those stores carrying, handling all that kind of money by herself? So yeah, that her damn father's a fucking mess. And then as soon as shit don't go his fucking way, he's quick to fire Kelly and, he's quick to fire Natalie and shit. I'm like, dude's an asshole. Straight up. So, it's like, shit, you're the one who practically got your daughter killed because of her, you know, doing all this shit. Quan marked her and planned on robbing her. Which actually kind of dawned in Joey's mind that you don't need to be taking all, you know, picking up all this money by yourself. Let me go with you. For Joey having the gun was his means of protecting Fawn. So yeah, it come to find out, you know, she was $15,000 was taken from her, which is fucking crazy. Next, we see Ben and Julius, you know, talking on the phone. Julius calls Ben and like, why the hell haven't you called me? And we can actually see that Julius, I think, is like at a gay bar because the music is thumping. So he's pretty much getting his life at the damn bar, and he's talking to Ben, and Ben is pretty much, you know, like kind of like, I don't know, I was going to call you, but, you know, things have been crazy around here lately. And he's like, look, you know, I mean, Julius is kind of like really in his feelings a little bit, like, yo, you were supposed to call me and you never called, you know, what the hell is up with that? You know, when I give you my number, you're supposed to call me. I shouldn't be calling you. You should be calling me. And he's like, yeah, I know. And, you know, and he pretty much even admits that, you know, I know that I shouldn't be calling you and I shouldn't really be around you, but I'm intrigued by you. And then Julius is like, oh really? I love fucking Julius, though. Julius is a fucking mess. And then pretty much they go back and forth or whatever. Julius and him are flirting, and then all of a sudden Eddie walks up, and Eddie's like, who the hell are you talking to? He's like, I'm talking to my girlfriend. He's like, oh, I'm your girlfriend now. Okay, what are you into, Ben? I'm like, Julius, you're the sickest ass damn. He is too hilarious. And he finally gets off the phone with him or whatever, tells him to get him a cup of coffee, and he's like, oh no, go to the store and get that vanilla latte whipped cream that I like, and also pick up my dry cleaning. I'm like, you know what, Eddie, you are doing the fucking most, because you have literally just made Ben like your personal bitch, and you have no problem exploiting him every chance you get. Well, I'm like, but yeah, Ben getting to the point he's getting tired of that shit, and we're going to see what Ben's going to do. Next, we also have Miss Diane, who is Tyrell's mother, call Kelly. Now, she let Kelly fucking have it. She like, first of all, bitch, my son did time for something you did, and he fucking tried to call you, and you ain't pick up your fucking phone. Now, you either pick up the damn phone the next time he calls, or I'm going to go to your damn job and let him know every fucking thing you did. Yeah, bitch, we want to know what the bank going to think about what you did, what you've done, that my son went down for you and did that so you can sit back and raise that nappy-head-ass boy. I'm like, come on now, Miss Diane. You ain't have to, I mean, she just is mean and just as mean as she can be. And then Kelly's like, look, don't you dare talk about my son. And Kelly was kind of talking back to her that time, but she was letting her know, like, look, bitch, if you don't answer my son the next time he calls, you're going to see what's going to happen. Oh, yeah. You're going to see what's going to happen. So Miss Diane done threatened her ass and let her ass know, like, bitch, next time, now, don't answer my fucking son's call and see that I'm not going to fuck you up. So there's another situation where Kelly is about to get her ass handed to her. So, Kelly better wise the fuck up. Next, we know we see Alex gets picked up by this hitchhiker, you know, because she's stranded now that her car, you know, is on fire. The guy picks her up. He actually noticed, he actually's like, you kind of pretty to be out here by yourself and everything. And he's like, and she said that, you know, her car broke down. And she's like, oh, you talking about that car back there that's on fire? He's like, yeah. And I was like, you mean that car that's on fire? And he's like, she's like, yeah, that's my car. And she's like, don't you want to report it to the police? And she's like, no, I just want to get to Dentonville. So we actually know she's actually heading to see her father. Sorry about that. That was just a call coming in. But, you know, they have a conversation, and Percy keeps saying, like, you're a real pretty girl. And she kind of gives him that look like, it's like, no. I'm not a perv. I've actually been married for over 50 years, and, you know, I'm just saying you're a pretty girl to be out here in this neck of the woods by yourself. I mean, there's some crazy people around here. And she's like, oh, yeah, I know. I mean, she's like, I grew up in Bentonville, so I know what the deal is. So he decides to put on some Christian music, which is exactly what Alex needs, because Alex has created so much hell. Maybe this Christian music will probably help guide her in the right direction. Hopefully. Next, we actually see Marcia's in the bathroom. Brad calls her. She finally answers, and she asks, did Brad kidnap Randall? Did Brad, you know, kidnap the baby? Did Brad do all of this shit? And she's saying that, no. And Brad pretty much tells her that, no, I didn't do anything. You know, you have to believe me. And she's like, I don't know what to believe right now. Did you kill Randall? Did you? And she's, like, breaking the fuck down. So it's crazy that through all of this shit that has went down, Marcy is still in love with Randall. Even though Randall did everything he could to break her, she still loves him. I mean, so love runs deep. So, but while they're having this conversation, the police show up, knock on the door, and it's Lieutenant Stevens, and he's got a crew of police with him. They go and search the house, and they find those boots, and they handcuff Brad, and that's how the episode ended. So I have to say, it's definitely moving along good, and I will definitely be back next week. Subscribe to my channel. Leave comments and, you know, like this video, and I will be back next week with another review of The Love You Was Wrong. So until then, guys, take care.